Hi, my name is Adwoa. In this video, we're going to look at the difference between your limit of detection and your limit of quantitation. But all I want to say is, how low can you go? Now, your limit of detection is referring to the lowest amount of the analyte that you can detect, but not necessarily be able to quantify or quantitate. The limit of quantitation, on the other hand, is the lowest amount of the analyte that you can detect, both detect and quantitate. It involves knowing the signal-to-noise ratio. There are various types of detection limits. You may be interested in detecting the limits of the instrument, so an instrument detection limit, or you may be detecting the method detection limit. And this one will involve you spiking in the actual analyte that you want to measure, like a lower amount of it, lower quantity of it. There are also practical quantification limits, or then also limits of quantification. So let's just look at the instrument detection limit. Samples in which there are no analytes, so just a blank. And so you will get a readout for the blank, and then you're going to go ahead and set your limit of detection at 3 times that of the noise or the signal, the background noise. Now, your limit of quantitation is your minimum amount of input, as I mentioned, in a sample that can be quantified with acceptable precision and accuracy under the stated operational conditions of the method. How do you determine this? First, you have to understand what's the minimum level at which you can reliably, reproducibly quantitate the sample, the analyte. And once again, just theoretically, it's set at 10 times the signal from your noise, from the standard deviation of your noise. Here, let's look at an analogy. Let's think about you watching this video and my voice is at this level, you can hear it. But what if I start to talk at this level? Can you still hear me? Now, what if I talk at this level? Can you still hear me? Now, what about at this level? So it's just how much of the analyte do you have in the system that's going to be detectable, and you're going to work out those parameters. Another way for determining your limit of detection and your limit of quantitation, other than measuring blanks and setting your detection limit as 3 times or your quantitation limit as 10 times the signal that you get from blanks, you could actually use your standard curve. And a standard curve is also called a calibration curve. So the thing to keep in mind with these sort of experiments or analyses is that you, in any measurement, set of measurements, there's a certain level of noise, background noise, that exists. And it affects, in particular, the lower levels of analytes, the lower concentrations. A practical example for determining the limit of detection is to take, say, 10 reagent blanks. So the blanks that have the same solvent as what your analyte will be dissolved in, not just water, but something that replicates exactly what the conditions, the buffers that your analyte would be in. And you're going to do 10 replicates of it. And so you're going to measure that and get an idea of what the standard deviation of that is. And that will give you the noise, the intrinsic noise in the system. So once you obtain the value for your replicate, which is the noise, the blank replicate, then you're going to set your instrument detection limit at 3 times that. Why do we multiply the noise by 3 standard deviations? Well, it's assuming that the readouts are normally distributed. And so if it's normally distributed, then by multiplying it by 3 standard deviations, we ensure that 99% of our data falls within that value. Every year, millions of analyses are performed around the world, and millions of decisions are made based on these analyses. Decisions like, can we safely consume this water or this food? Or things like, was the driver drunk when he crashed? Or is this sportsman using drugs to enhance his performance? These sort of questions are answered by performing chemical analyses in samples. See, until the 1970s, it was assumed that the report submitted by laboratories accurately described the study that was performed. But suspicion about this assumption was raised during the review of some data. Data inconsistencies and evidence of unacceptable laboratory practices came to light. Look at this reference from Hirsch AF, published in 1989. Since then, several agencies like the United States Food and Drug Administration, the International Conference for Harmonization, ICH, the United States Pharmacopeia, USP, the International Standards Organization, have created working groups to ensure the validity and reliability of studies. These groups eventually published standards for measuring the performance of laboratories and enforcing policy. So good laboratory practice regulations were finally produced or proposed in 1976. And the proposal was to validate methods that are being used. Now, in order to resolve the previous problems, several protocols and guidelines on method validation have been prepared. Method validation consists of a series of tests that both proves any assumptions which the analytical method is based. Limit of detection and limit of quantification are part of these proposals that were made under the validation of your method. It also includes things like selectivity or specificity, calibration, accuracy and recovery, precision, range, etc. But in this video, we're looking at limit of quantification and limit of detection. So there is a difference between your limit of detection and your limit of quantification. And the difference is really how far away from the standard deviation you are. If you're only 3.3 times away from the noise, then you are able to say, hey, you've got something. I just don't know how much. But then if I'm like 10 times above the noise, I can be in a better position with precision to say how much of that particular analyte or substance you've got in that sample. To calculate it from blank readings, so where you've done multiple reads, so replicates of your blanks, you basically will need the average of those reads, then add that to 3 times the standard deviation of those reads, and that will set your limit of detection. And if you wanted the limit of quantitation, then it would be 10 times. So the alternative method, which I showed, was to read it from your standard curve. And so that you will need the plot and you need the equation of the line in order to calculate it. When you're using the standard curve, you're going to need the line of best fit, which is referred to as the regression line. You take the intercept of that slope where it hits the y-axis, and on this plot you can see I've indicated it with the letter B, and you can see that I've shown multiple B's depending on, you know, what the slope would be. The slope is given the alphabet M. And so basically, to determine the limit of detection, you're going to depend on where your B hits. You're going to take that and 3 times the standard deviation of that, you'll be able to come down and read what the concentration is. And that would be your limit of detection. And of course, 10 times the concentration of that would be your limit of quantitation. So once again, my name is Adwoa. Thank you very much for checking out this video. And I'm going to wish you all the best with your limit of quantitation and limit of detection experiments. Catch you in the next one. Bye.